the Board of Trustees, Board of Facilities and Community Relations. We're meeting today at 1:30. In addition to myself, Trustee Ellen Stoddard is here. Trustee Anna Everett is here. We are the three members of the Subcommittee. Before we start, I guess I would ask if there are any public comments. I see Art Olguin's.
Art Olguin and I believe Jamie Campbell.
Okay. Shudder.
Yeah.
Hey, how you doing?
Hi, good to see you. I just, from the Santa Barbara County Taxpayers Association Planning Assignment.
Yeah.
And able to stay for all the meeting, but I hope to find out more about the proposal. I know that there are several other meetings coming up, so.
Excellent.
Do you have a handout of that material? That would be helpful if you've got it in paper.
And we are at the public comment stage of it, so if you had a public comment, this would be the time.
Okay, good. Well, I'll just say that we were very, as the board members know, the email correspondents thought that the direction of the $8.50 as an extension of the existing tax is the best way to go for a variety of reasons. The first being that the poll results weren't super strong. You know, I mean, they were okay, but not like sometimes they were good. And then secondly, I think that, and this is someone who, again, we strongly supported the last Measure S in 2014, is that, you know, I think that City College should go for a larger bond. It's my personal opinion. Mm-hmm. Bond at some point in the future, and sort of to go now for 12 bucks when you can probably get 850 now as an extension, and then in 4 or 6 years, go back for 16 or 18 more, I think would be, you know, you literally might lose hundreds of millions of dollars over time from what you get. So that, and again, those are decisions for a future day, but eight now, you know, it sounds like there'd be good projects, and I think that'd be a good way to go. So that our view is that less is more in this circumstance.
Okay, Anna?
Yes. I was interested in your comment that perhaps we should go for more later. When is the later that your group is thinking would be optimal?
Well, you got to remember, and as I said, we were very involved in the 2008 campaign or 9 campaign, very involved in 2014, and we are 24. So the point is, later might be 10 years from now, as far as, but I guess my feeling is that it's from having watched these for a long time, it's, you know, uncertain economic and international times are not conducive to large bonds, as far as it's not the merits of the issue, it's the larger circumstance. So that my own feeling is, if you were to ask me, maybe 2028, you know, in terms of it seems like you know, that would be, if this one were successful and it passes and does well, and then new PE buildings opened up and everybody thinks it's great, you know, all that kind of stuff, and the economy is doing better and the international situation is a little more calm than it is now, then that's something that, you know, and it's not on the ballot. You've already got a new, I guess here's my point, is that if you put a new 2024 bond on the ballot, then I think you really are delayed for quite a while. Whereas if it isn't that, then I think that you would have an argument to come back sooner rather than.
Let me interject. This is a separate agenda item later. We don't ordinarily get into dialogue with public commenters, but I do have one just to clarify or comment. When you, there is kind of a dollar amount that we're looking at in terms of an extension. And that dollar amount was about 200 million somewhere in that area. Is that?
I think that's a good amount. No, and if you can get that at the 850, I think that's excellent. As far as that's a lot of resource for, that's more than, yeah, that's a lot of resource for City College. We strongly argued against the 279. We endorsed it, but in the preliminary discussions, we thought that the 279 million in 2014 was too much. And, you know, so that in real terms, you know, 200 million is a reasonable amount. And as I say, I think the fact that it appears to be focused on the main campus is something that there was always a problem in past elections with anything to do with continuing education sites. And are they going to be reutilized? And of course,
well, I'd encourage you, if you can, to stick around to our third agenda item, which is a discussion of the project, you know, possible project list. Well, Nick, you've seen that as a...
That's my question. Yeah. Do you want me to wait on that?
Yeah, I would prefer to
wait. I will. Sorry about that.
That's all right. But we've got...
Art Olguin.
Mm-hmm. If we could go to him.
Yeah, he just needs to unmute because we're in...
He may want to comment when we get to...
Yes, in fact, I would like to comment when you get to the item. It sounded like I just came in and you were in the middle of, I'm not sure what, preliminary discussion or something.
There you go. So would you prefer to wait till we get to the agenda item?
I would, yes, and then I'll raise my hand.
And which agenda item is it that you want to comment on? The bond projects or...
I wanted to comment, actually, I had comments on all three items of your agenda.
Okay, so you wanted to have three separate comments as we get to each item?
Yes, real focused. And if I have a comment, then I'll raise my hand.
Okay, well, why don't we get your comment on the first agenda item, which is item 3.1, the facilities vision plan. Do you have a comment on that?
I was pleased to see this draft of the facilities vision plan, even though it was only a few chapters available to read. As I went through it, there were several things that leapt out at me, and I understand that this is a draft and that it will be, you know, that you'll be adding to it. There were sections, for example, under characteristics of, I'm now looking for my notes, characteristics of effective service areas. I just thought that there were some additional descriptive information that was needed so the members of the public understood what it was that you were actually talking about. You've got some data, some charts there, but there's not enough information to know, well, what are you really talking about? For example, you talk about the 93109 zip code. And yet that whole section, it's unclear whether or not this is for, that these data are for the credit program, or is it both credit and non-credit program? Really not sure what. It would also be nice to have, you know, a picture of what that 93109 is in relationship to the other zip codes in the area. The educational backgrounds of the students, you have a chart there that doesn't provide enough description. Is it for current students, or is that the descriptive profile for current students? So, and a date also would be helpful for indicating what those data represent. And then there's a chart that says, you know, that we have the number of high school students from Ventura County. And again, I think that it could be revised to also include Ventura and Santa Barbara. If you're really providing a vision plan of the service area, then that information should be there in the plan. I found some errors in the plan. Again, I understand that this is a draft, and I'll try and put my comments into writing as well so that you can have them. But on page 29, the charts need greater messaging, because what is really surprising is, as you're talking about the programs that are showing growth and the programs that are showing shrinkage, you have a career guidance and orientation with a 70% growth rate. And yet, and again, it's really not a credit discipline. It's not a discipline, It's a particular course that is offered by the Career Center, which is a an academic support, an educational support division program. So it really, that graph and the items that you have in it really are, in my view anyway, not truly representative of academic programs, so that you can see where growth and, where shrinkage may be. And the same thing goes with library sciences. You put that in there, indicating that it may mean something significant, but it really only has a 0.2% increase. And that's really not statistically significant, in terms of trying to describe the growth of the college in terms of its academic program. So this is not to, I've only read it, in a very Evelyn Wood speed reading kind of way, but those are just a couple of things that jumped out at me. I may be merging this comment with a comment that I might be making, in another agenda item. I apologize if I do. But the budget sustainability workgroup document that Cambridge presented, there were several findings actually in that April 16th document, where, and one of the clear findings is that we are overbuilt in lecture and laboratory spaces and underbuilt in office spaces. That just was a very clearly addressed. And yet, again, on page 24 of that budget sustainability workgroup document, it noted that cap load ratios are over 200%, twice the needed space, with twice the space needed for laboratory classes. And yet, when I go back and look at your FVP on page 29, the only science credit discipline with positive enrollment gain from 2015 to 2022 was botany, general botany. That's the only science class that's shown.
Could we ask you to kind of wrap up your comments? Your 5 minutes is elapsed.
Oh, okay. Well, then I'll just wrap it up, and when the next agenda item comes that I may have something to say about, then I'll try and finish it up. I really do appreciate taking the time to review the document. I think there's a lot of information there. I'm trying to integrate is what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to integrate with other material from your work groups. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Who is next up? I see Josh Ramirez is on, and also another name I can't read. Joe.
No, that's us. That's us. That's us.
Okay, Josh.
I did not put in a request for public comments. I am simply here just to be able to listen in. Okay. I did have some feedback, but I will follow up with the subcommittee over email. There are just two minor things, and maybe just one point for the data on facilities usage at the WCC building that I'll be following up on, but that's an email, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So is there anybody else? Does that take care of it?
Yep. Yeah.
Okay. So, Erica, or Brian, do you want to
introduce? We received this, an hour before we sent it out, practically. It's a draft, and I thought it would be good to share it just to show what we've been doing. It obviously has a lot of work to do, even in the first four chapters. And we're working on the remainder part too, but we did really literally just receive it. And I thought I would share what we've done in the past, the report, the work we've done, we've all of us participated in the report itself, the drafting of it, only the consultant did. And so all of the things that has been mentioned and many more. We'll go through it in more detail, make sure it's exactly what we want to, you know, is our vision, and how it's presented. So, but I just wanted to share it. Really, literally, it is a. I even put it in bold. It's a first draft. And so we've had very little time to look at it. Besides for the other things that we're doing right now, too.
Could you just describe quickly for us what has gone on campus with respect to working with the the consultant to arrive at the point there?
We formed a campus committee from the various constituent groups and started at that process. And then we broke into the consultant met with different groups. I'm not sure how many, maybe about 15 different groups. Both on the main campus and Shot and Wake, to go over, what their facilities look like today. Just sort of the various parts of this is like sort of what is the facility? Is the relative condition of the facilities now? They toured every space, went through our plan, our maintenance plans and things like that. They assessed the buildings from some condition. Report. And then they met with the different groups and talked about what's growing and what's not growing. What do they see? What do all these groups see? And that's sort of what was tried to be conveyed in this report, was that part, that first part. Just how are we doing? What our facilities look like? What's the vision of the group in terms of enrollment, program growth, and things like that?
I have some comments or questions, but first I'd like to ask whether Ellen or...
No.
Anna?
No, just
let me get my notes here. I was very interested in the, even though it's a draft, it was still I found it interesting to read and think of all the different areas that stand or that need improvement, whether it's landscaping, whether it's finding your way, whether it's whether we replace or fix traffic patterns, bicycle paths, pedestrian paths. And, it did strike me that we do have a lot of work to do to try to integrate all these things. And I believe that's what the vision plan is for. So I found some questions I had, but similar to Mr. Dolan's comments, I did notice that we had information on decreases in student populations in Ventura, but not Santa Barbara. So it was interesting that Ventura was showing an increase, and I would expect maybe we're showing a decrease based on other data.
I'm not sure, but I agree with you. I thought it was interesting. That's why I put it on the agenda. Yeah. I thought it's got months of work left in it, but I thought the condition it's in now is still worth looking at and see where we are.
The other thing that struck me is I was, as I read it, I was thinking about possible bond measure and how that fits and whether there are additional things we need from the vision plan before we can make a decision on the bond measure. And I decided in my own mind that we can make a considered judgment on our project list without having the division plan, because in fact I didn't really see any inconsistency in the division plan with what we're going to talk about later with the bond list. Some things are so, I guess the way I'd say it, some things are so obvious right now. We don't need a vision plan to tell us we need to do X, Y, and Z.
Well, and I think too. One of Art's points talking about the way that lecture and lab space is described here and office space and all of that. I think one thing to keep in mind is that we're not actually expanding the campus. If we potentially go for a bond, it is about replacing buildings that have come to the end of life and replacing buildings that are highly utilized, not a smaller building and all of that. So I think what the vision plan does is help identify as we're going forward And I think that Brian has been doing this since he's been here, you know, looking at things like Antioch, like how can we better use our space? How can we make the campus what it needs to be to support our community? And I think that's where I think the vision plan helps. And when I look at this versus like 2019, when there was a vision facilities master plan, I think it is very consistent. And the only thing that's changed in that time is 5 more years of wear and tear on our buildings.
Anna.
So I just have a couple of general. Oh, was it Anna?
No, after you.
Oh, okay. Okay. A couple of general comments. One, I agree, there are no surprises in here. It's very consistent with what we've been talking about all along in the facilities and general board meetings. So it just, you know, is a report to back up what we kind of already know. Secondly, I really like the emphasis on calling it the Schott Center, the Wake Center, and the Cliff Campus.
Mm-hmm. Campuses.
Yes, mm-hmm. The three campuses. I think that that's really inclusive language in, mm-hmm. for the community. And I really, I think it raises an importance, the Schott and the Wake Center, which I think is important as considering that this is the Facilities and Community Relations Committee. I think it's very important.
Good. I agree.
Just a couple of things. I agree with what I've heard so far. And Ellen, I'm just, do you mean the Schott campus or center?
Well,
you
it's
were
the same.
Okay,
thing.
Okay. One of the things that I like, I think this is just, you know, visually a really good kind of representation of the arguments. That for people who haven't been following along, it gives them, you know, some people are visual learners. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I really like having this. The problem I have is that it makes things look too good.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? The buildings don't look like, you know, it's not a good representation of the wear and tear. And so I don't know if that should be something that can be considered for an appendix mm-hmm. or something. But I mean, it just, you know, the pictures just look too good for the buildings and it doesn't look like we need, you know what I'm saying?
So that's all. But other than that, I
agree with what was said. It clearly it's a work in progress. I really think it's a nice, opening, place for us to start.
Let me get to Ellen, let me just, I have a comment on Anna just said, and that is, that I pictures are a great idea, and I think that we probably will be getting some pictures as we mm-hmm. move forward on the bond to show to the community where we really need some work. But I also know that even though the pictures in there look good, there's other information like facilities condition index that shows the numbers, at least for all of our buildings. But what I found interesting in reading it is we can't be too slavish to those numbers
mm-hmm.
because the numbers don't, I mean, there are some numbers that are kind of high that would suggest we need to replace a building, but you look further and no, we don't necessarily need to replace a building. There's others that maybe are a little lower. But for other reasons beyond this, just mere calculation number. So I just express a caution about use of the FCI as they. So,
yeah. Well, I just really want, I think that Trustee Everett makes an excellent point. A lot of people are not going to read the report. They're going to look at the pictures. Right. Yeah. So we need some pictures of potholes and.
Get rid of the sailboats.
Potholes and bad bathrooms and all that.
Oh, we've got plenty of pictures.
Yeah. No, I agree.
Broken elevator.
Right. So is there anything else that we want to talk about?
But I applaud the effort. I mean, you know, just as a start, it's a good, you know, baseline.
Okay. Well, let's go to oh, my mouse isn't working.
There we go. He's controlling
it. There we go. Oh, nice. So our next item 3.2.
Sorry, I mislabeled them. Yes, 3.1 on there.
It's a different one, yeah.
Yeah.
That's going to be that one.
Yeah. Everyone, here we go.
Okay, so I guess we need to go back to Art Ogie to, I think he had comments on this item as well. Is he still with us?
No. Well, yeah.
There he is.
I would prefer to raise my hand when I had something to say. Is that acceptable?
Okay. We're now heading into item 3.2, and you would like to wait on that?
I would like to wait on that, please.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, Brian, can you introduce this?
Yes. Topic? So, the capital projects fund 43. Is the fund where we accumulate and spend money for capital improvements. The majority of the money there typically comes from annual appropriations that we take from the general fund. The state contributes quite a bit into that fund the years that that money is available statewide. And as you know, they contributed for a few years and they gave us our biggest payment in many years would have been the current year. No, I'm sorry, last year. And then at the end of the year, they took it back.
23.
Yeah, and they took it back. So they took it back $7 million from us. And we had money going back probably to like 17, 18, something like that in projects, because they come in, each one of them is their own sub fund. And we set up a number of projects and we work on them. And we knew that we were getting this money. And so we had sort of prioritized projects that way, given that we were going to have $7 million last year. And they took it back from us. And so it really kind of scrambled everything because we needed to rethink our priorities. And so that's why I don't have actual dollar amounts by these projects, is because I just wanted to show, like in, if you go to 44.9 state maintenance projects 21-22, there it is. There's this $3.4 million. Mm-hmm. That's how much money we have in that fund in total. And those are the projects that we are hoping to work on with that money. And while we may have scoped those projects at one level in the past, they're totally different since we use some of that money to do some of our more higher priority things later and we reprioritize. So, but I just wanted to show you some of the things that we are using state maintenance fund. And you can see the top line is how much money we still have left in our capital projects fund for the PE building. So in the project of funding, you know, the state gives us $35 million. We had seven, and then the rest of it would come from a bond measure if we do that. So we still have seven there. And if we get the bond measure passed, we may want to take that $7 million and reappropriate it down to some of the things that we were unable
to. We have the ability to
do that. It's our money. That's a district funded.
Right.
The ones that say state maintenance, those are the ones that the state gave us the money for. And we applied for that money for specific projects. So once they took the money back from us last year, they've been very flexible and allowing us to move money where we want.
So these projects under each of these categories, well, just take the first one, the 21-22, these are the ones we selected
as
being the highest priority.
We selected them back when we asked for that money. We said, here are our projects, here's how much each one is, and the state approves some and disapproves some.
Okay.
But they gave us money for those, and it was more than that because we've used some of that money for other things since then. But now with that increased flexibility, I wanted to just list some of the things or all the projects that we had there, and knowing that that's how much money we have left. So I'm not sure how much of that will get accomplished. Okay. But all I was trying to show you is we started the year with like $19 million or something in this fund. We're ending with around $16 million. I just wanted to show you some of the things that we're working on. That's really the purpose of this whole item, is just to show you that we have $16 million, seven of that being for the gym. And the rest of it is for projects that we hope to do.
Are some of these projects also listed in the proposed bond? Just totally separate.
No, these are separate projects. Yeah. Now, like it says, rebuilding HVAC units, we could go on and on because we have many of those needing it. So,
Kellen, go ahead.
Well, I see some things on here that like we'd probably not do, like reseal the gym floor. If we're going to rebuild the PE building, would we still reseal the gym floor?
It's not a very expensive project, and we can get another year of use out of it.
So we would.
So yeah, there, it's not. And we, in fact, I think that one may be one of them we were already working on now. Is to have
the gym. Health and safety issue, because right. If you don't seal it on a regular basis, then you run into people actually getting injured on the floor.
Right.
And since we're, you know,
still using it.
Yeah, we're still using it. We still have to take care of some of those things, but it's not very expensive.
Okay.
But to the extent that we have in our, you know, plan to eventually tear down a building, we're trying to minimize the amount of money we put into mm-hmm. it to keep it habitable for the years until then, but not fix it like we would if we were planning okay. to keep it forever. So we're... And all of our buildings, not all, many of our buildings fall into that category.
Okay.
The campus center, we knew that it needed to be replaced. We couldn't afford it. So we tried to keep it functional, but without going too far, because it still needs to be replaced.
Yeah.
Student services building is the same one. So that's all, this is, again, just a very light information item, just to show you sort of the magnitude of the money that we have there and the types of things we're planning to do with it.
So the third category.
I have a question before we move on.
Sure.
You said we started with 19, then we're going to be ending up around 17.
16. Yes.
16, right? And I'm wondering when the funds were allocated, and does this have to do with the lack of spending, the whole returning from the lockdown, or has there just not been any activity to kind of make these changes? If we're starting with 19 and ending with, you know, it looks like nothing has been spent essentially. So I'm just wondering, is that because of the delayed either assessments or work because of returning from COVID, or is it just that we've been waiting for something to spend the money? I'm not sure.
Our ability to manage it. It's our ability. Whenever you look at the plan, the physician plan, or this plan, keep in mind the list over here, right? So when it says, you know, carpet or whatever, we spend a lot of time fixing an elevator that broke, or fixing a bathroom that quit working, and one day we had a fire alarm fail in the humanities building, a flood in the bookstore, and a fire in the campus center fan. In one day.
One day.
That's where we spend our time. So how come the vision plan is not better? Because we spend our time on this list.
I got it.
Right?
Plugging and dying.
So that's it. So we are so far behind that we can't do the thing. So we did $2 million worth of projects because we can't manage more.
Okay.
So let me ask it another way. In a way, this is a wish list, is it not? These projects on the fund.
Correct. Yes, that's it.
And we'd like to do them all, but there are things not on the list that happen, which we've got to do.
Right.
On the Fund 43
project? Yeah, I mean, there are things that aren't on the 43 projects that you have to deal with here and now.
Correct.
So, and that takes away money that might be available to...
It certainly takes away management attention mm-hmm. and time that our staff is constantly battling to keep the place operating. Whereas if it was in generally better shape, they would be able to plan, execute,
deliver just better. That if there's something, an emergency that happens, that costs a lot of money to fix.
Right.
The money we spend on that. Is money that is not available then
right,
to do
right. some of these. I got
and it may not be our highest priority thing is to, you know, we it wasn't yeah. on, but it would, if
the flooding
it fails, and, it right. becomes immediately yeah, the right. highest priority. So right. that's one of our biggest issues is our staff is totally consumed with chasing after the latest failure somewhere.
A whack-a-mole.
So this is sort of a parking lot issue. I don't know that it's not part of this agenda, but it's something that I feel like our committee needs to address. And that is that I feel that Brian is stretched too thin. And we sort of, I think we need to separate out the head of budget and the money and the head of facilities. It's too much. It's too much for one person to do. But it's not part of this agenda. So put it on the in the parking lot, please.
No, that's fine. Just the door.
It's a sad story, isn't it?
What's that?
It's a sad story.
Yes, it is.
And I noticed there is the bond list. One of the projects on the bond, I don't know if you saw that, is repairing the streets, mainly the entrances.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, and part of that we need to do because it's part of a city project.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so
we want to coordinate.
We want to coordinate. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, any other comments?
That's helpful, thank you.
On this item? Okay, let's go to the...
Oh, Art has his hand up.
Okay, Art, do you have a
comment? Thank you for letting me just raise my hand because you answered a lot of the questions that I had, and I was glad to hear your discussion. But Brian, my question is, does the Fund 43, does that category roll over from year to year? Is there any real, how long can it accumulate?
Well, it rolls, it stays its own fund. It rolls over every year. And so those projects are ongoing. The state generally gives us about 5 years to use their money. But again, they're not as much a stickler on that as they have been because if they realize the tremendous change, you know, with taking all that money back. So
yeah, well,
it's our money. It stays there forever till we use it.
Okay. So there's doesn't sound like there's a potential for clawback of those funds.
Well, that's what they did, actually. They gave us the money. And since we were overwhelmed with the day-to-day operations, we hadn't done those projects. Other community college districts that have, you know, a bond measure or whatever in their past, and they're using that money every year, they had started those projects and the state pulled that money back. Mm. It's not, this probably won't be clawed back what's in this fund today, but generally speaking, they can. Just like they can take back our COVID money or anything else, if they see our records as clearly as we do, mm-hmm. So they know that it's there.
Yes.
We're a funding source for, maybe not a funding source, because they used our facilities money to give us our raise this year, literally, right? They gave us an 8% raise and they took back money from the prior year and said, this will fund it 1 year. Well, now we're going into the next year and they're having to scrape to get that. And then it's a
maintenance,
right? It's a complicated story, but yeah. They can call back the money, Art, if you really want to know.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Art. I had one final question. Just maybe I missed this. The category district projects, does that differ from the state projects in the sense that we have more flexibility or control over?
Right.
They can't reach in and grab that money.
Correct. The PE building is a district project. And then these other ones, this is money every year that we push over to the, you know, some trustees would say we push over too little.
Yeah.
And we do. But this is an accumulation of money that's there. That was in the unrestricted general fund or from some other fund on the campus.
Okay.
But that is our money. So the P building, district projects, and the classroom improvement fund are all our money.
Okay. Okay. Anything else? If not, we'll move on to agenda item 3.3, which is the bond project. list. And before we get into that, I would again ask if we have any public comments on this. Start with Manny Evanston.
Great, thank you, Bob. One quick question is that I think it would be very helpful to include state funding on the bond project list. I presume that the $60 million is the local amount on the PE and $50 million on physical science. And on this document, I don't see how much the state is going to be including on those or other projects. And I think that'd be very helpful because you want people from the start to say, it costs $60 million that we're putting in, but the whole project is $100 million, whatever.
I guess I should have asked Brian or Erica to start on this before I went to comments. I had the same question when I saw the list, and the answer is
35 or 34, and that's what the physical side, physical education building.
But that's in addition to the 60.
Correct.
That's
34.
No other money, and that's kind of a. That's an important part of this is that because we have returned money twice and we are literally on the cusp of returning it a third time, that the community college system will not go on our behalf to the Department of Finance and get money for us. They won't. In fact, the physical science building, we had put in a final project proposal asking for money and they told us to take it out because they don't trust that we will actually spend it. Literally, that is the position we're in.
But you will get state funding if it passes, correct?
No. We stand in line with others, and they take a bet on the community college that's going to spend.
For the physical science.
You're asking.
Oh, for the physical education building?
We have that.
You've got the $34 million.
Yes.
Correct?
What we don't have is money for the physical science.
I see. So that's a question mark.
Yeah.
We have the $34 million. If we encumber it by July of 25, that means we have 11 months or 12 months to pass a bond measure, go out to bid, find a contractor, and enter into a contract for a $100 million project. So we are in the last minutes of this.
Sure.
So, but in
any event, if you are able to indicate on how much would come, you know, from the state, I think that'd be helpful. And if it's, you know, we apply of the $50 million for $10 million or $15 million or $20 million or $5 million, whatever it may be, I think it would be, and again, with a question mark as to whether or not it'll be received, I think that would be helpful. The quick comments I wanted to make from having, again, if I can just give one general comment too, and I don't mean to be anything other than I served on the Santa Barbara Board of Education in 1990, so I truly have all of these issues for one time locally, is that City College only got one bond in the whole, you know, period. And the bonds, you know, started passing again in the 80s and 90s, and City College went from one like 99 that didn't pass, and it hadn't gone from one since the 60s, since that time. And then it finally got a $77 million bond or something like that in 2008 or 2010. And then it went for the 279 in 2014 that it didn't get. The point is that I can see from the list that it's largely just there's tens of millions of dollars of stuff that just hasn't been done for a long time, and you just need to do it, okay? So I think in terms of formulating your campaign, it's important. This is a largely maintenance bond in terms of, okay, so that's clear. And I just wanted to give that a little bit of background that you probably are all familiar with, but it ain't at the
end. Totally agree.
What I would say is two things is, and this is only Bob again mentioned, I don't see any line item even for $500,000 on landscaping or something like that, because I just feel that, you know, particularly along Cabrillo Boulevard, you know, and the parking lot there, and then up Loma Alta and all that kind of stuff, it just looks terrible. And the point is, it was when it was built in the 40s, it was the outskirts of town. There was nothing up here, et cetera, et cetera. No homes, residences. And to leave that permanently an eyesore on Cabrillo Boulevard for not, you know, literally a few tens, hundreds of thousands of dollars. And again, from having done the bonds with the school districts before in the past, you know, the final plan is going to be, you do your best job, but the point is that your final plan is going to be significantly different than your budgets. You know, expenditures that are going to be going on for years are going to be different than your budgets today. So I think that if you do have some line item in there, it is something that it doesn't have to be excessive, but it is something that'd be good. The other thing too is I believe that in the past, and there was mention about the Cliff Drive entry improvements on the east-west entry. Mm-hmm. Is that for main campus or is that the one further down up the road?
Both. And it's the city is going to improve Cliff Drive.
Yeah.
And we have been working with them to participate in that project. And this is our share of their project.
This is something that's been talked about for years. Yes. And, you know, roundabout ideas and the transportation of the buses is terrible and people, you know, the way the fences are and all that stuff. You know, the point is that it really ought to be cleaned up. And I personally think that that's kind of a low figure for what it's worth. Maybe there's already an approved plan. And
there is.
Okay.
And this is one where they put a stoplight, both entrances,
okay,
with a proper way to bus it across the
signage,
street.
Signage,
so people have to walk.
Signage, yeah.
So this is, and we've done a presentation. We have a very nice presentation that we can show you that shows both of these have a very nice, and the money that's in. One of the few things on that list that actually has some backing about an estimate, that's one of them.
Okay, well, all right. And it's all, how much is this? Because I thought it was going to be like a $15 million project or something like
not
that.
Not for us. The cities is huge.
Is the city going to put in like 10 or 11 or something?
More than that.
Oh, really?
It's the whole from, yeah. It's
because we're going to do a bike path,
yeah,
and, you know,
correct,
clean up,
correct,
the whole,
yes,
Cliff Drive. Yeah,
yeah,
the huge project.
Lights up the.
I'll stop there, but I just want to say that, you know, aesthetics are important. The entrance to the campus has not been good, and the landscaping along Cabrera Boulevard and on Cliff Drive, or rather Loma Alta, has not been good either. And even a small amount, you know, like I said, if you get additional funding or something like that from the state, that'll give you a little flexibility. There's always interest on bonds after they pass that gives you a little extra cash. So it's something that if you have that in as a line item, it would give you your future boards a little bit more time, but it looks like a great list. And again, I can see there's just a bunch of stuff that's got to be done. The physical education building, the physical science building, this is a very strong proposal in my mind that the community should support. So
thank you. That's the way we see it too. I mean, they are easily defendable necessities. Really, they're necessities. And half of it, if you look at it, half of it is just repair and fix and things like the entrances to the campus. Ellen,
I have a comment.
But
I
think actually we should get all the public comments first. I'm sorry. And Art, did you have something else to tell us on this item?
Well, I don't want to tell you. I am interested in hearing what your conversation is, and of course. But I am curious, how were these numbers, how were these estimates generated? Is it sort of back of the envelope kind of thing? And if it's not an accurate estimate, could these be underestimates? I would wonder. Again, I look at the physical science project, which is slated for new and replacement construction at 50 million. And I presume that would be our campus in-kind contribution and not the total cost for the project. And I would hope that you would answer that at some point. Apart from the PE project, this actually does seem like the decision is a priority for the college, whereas in your documentation you say it's not listed in priorities. Well, it actually is a priority. And I don't know whether or not this matches with the facilities condition index, because I didn't have time to go back and look at that right now. It looks to me that, and you just were talking about this just a few minutes ago, where you said that physical science, we were told to take it out of the list that we had by the chancellor's office, to take it out. So I'm not understanding how it is that jives with putting in a proposal for a bond if we you know, if it hasn't been approved. So where are we then with the approval process?
Let me respond to that, and Brian, correct me if I'm wrong, but on the money has been committed to us on the PE building. And as Brian explained a few moments ago, we need to spend it soon. And that's where the bond project comes in. If we don't do a bond, we probably are going to lose that money.
We'll give it back the next
day. We'll have to give the $34 million back.
Yeah, but I think he was also talking
So as to the other building, as I understand it, we submitted what's called a initial, or was it the final we submitted? And they said, well, I don't see, you don't have the money, so we're not going to commit to our part right now. If we do a bond and have the money, that's a different story then. So I think that we will be able to say to the community, it's our expectation that we will be able to get state funding for the physical science building, which will reduce, instead of having to spend $50 million, our share would be something less than that. In other words, the $50 million doesn't assume an additional amount of money from the state. Is that?
No, I think it does.
So wait a minute, is that correct?
No, we had an estimate to replace the building of around $35 million, which is several years ago. Mm-hmm. And so we've accelerated that the same as we did with the gym, which we know has gone up, and said it's $50 million.
So the $50 million is you are, this list does assume then that we will get additional funding for it. In other words, $50 million is not the cost.
Our cost of it's our it's the total cost of the building as we know it today.
$50 million.
And that again is based off of an estimate that's some years old. But if we pass a bond, then we could apply for state funding. Now we would be standing in line with a bunch of other colleges who have both applied, received, and spent money over the years. We have not done that. We will have started a project that way, but we will still be standing in line with having turned back two buildings. So we'll still have, we won't be their number one customer.
I understand. So I just want to be clear on the record that the $50 million is our estimate of the cost. Forget whether we get state money.
Right. Exactly. We could get money, and hopefully we would, and then that would go down to say $15 million or something, and we would have the 35 come from the state.
Let me ask this, which I think is important for everybody to know, is when you say we had to give back money in two buildings, one, this was before my time, but as I understand it, there was a certain amount of money allocated for the campus center replacement, and we ended up not using that money. Do you know how much that was?
No, I don't know. That was the second time.
It was in the tens of millions, though.
Correct.
And there was, what was the other project?
The School of the Media of Arts building.
Yeah, the
Soma building or whatever was going to go on the other side of students. So
we've done this twice.
Yeah.
Correct. And the getting awarded the money and giving it back is one thing, but both of those instances, we gave it back so late in the game, it couldn't be used again.
Yeah.
So that's why I say if we don't pass a bond in November, there's other people still waiting, right? And so they're going to probably go to bid 10 seconds later, and because we'll need to give that money back to the chancellor's office so they can reallocate it to another shovel-ready project.
So if we have to give that money back, we not only lose the $34 million, we establish an even firmer reputation with the state.
Correct.
Forget us again. We're not going to waste our time with you because it never happens.
Right. Right. They go to the legislature, they get money, and then they end up saying, how come we didn't spend it? Well, we don't have a good reason.
Okay.
We took the physical science building out of our application for state funding. It's still a priority for us. But we just took it out because we were ready to go. So that's what Art's question was, I think.
So, you know, the PE building, it's tricky because it's like the least, according to the poll that was conducted recently, it was sort of like the least favorite project for the college to spend money on. And yet, we need to spend the money on it because we can't turn back the state money again. So we're going to have to find a way, I think, to explain this to the community.
Yeah, and I think I've had some conversations with folks, and I think one of the things is to talk about the role of that building in the community. For example, we house debris flow victims in that building. That is one of the major ways that we help the local community when it comes to emergency operations, emergency preparation.
Mm-hmm.
And we also do a lot of community. There are a lot of community activities that happen in there. And it's also, there are classrooms in there. So it is, I think what we have to do is maybe stop just calling it a PE building because that limits the scope of what really happens in the building.
What could we call
so
it?
I think that's going to be part of the conversation. If we go forward, we really do need to have a much more inclusive
multi-purpose
title.
Multi-purpose building.
Something that's more than it's just a gym because it's so much more.
Okay, can I have two other things?
Can I just comment on that one? Topic, and that is that our agenda item today has to do with the project list, but what you're touching on is our messaging to the community. And that's a whole nother topic that I know that we're going to be spending a lot of work on, a lot of time on, and having the reason, you know, having very specific reasons why we need things on this project list. In addition to what President Andrew Jonathan just told us about the community use of the building, just that it's one of the worst buildings on campus in terms of condition.
I know that.
I'm saying these are the things that, it's what, as Kathy O'Connor has told us, we really don't comply with Title IX.
I know.
There are things on and on like that that we're all going to have those.
But those are more PE oriented.
Yeah.
I think that our emphasis really needs to be on the multi. But that is a different conversation.
Yeah. Cool. I don't think you have to do all those things.
So in general, I really like this list. I like it a lot, and I like that it includes all three campuses. I think that that's really important. So I noticed that the total on the list is $215 million, which kind of coincides with how much we would be asking for if we do the extension. Is that correct?
No, it's more.
It's more.
It's more. And we stopped at $215 million. It's not our need. It's a portion of our need. We tried to not spend a lot of money on buildings that we knew we eventually needed to take out. So it is our estimate of what things cost that we know about today.
Okay, so if we do the extension, how much money do we?
$198 million is what the $8.50 does.
Basically,
so,
$200 million.
Yeah. So, so we would prioritize. That's one of the reasons why I said it's not prioritized. We would prioritize this list.
Okay.
You know, because also the two big ones, those are estimates, right? Mm-hmm. So when you go out for $100 million PE building, the real estimate is what the bid comes back and what the project, because we're tearing down a building and there's a lot of uncertainty and, you know, building it right back in the same place and all that. So those are estimates as well. So we'll see how we do on that. And so then it tells you with our highest priority one is obviously getting the PE building built. The next one is the physical science, and we would go out for a design for that. We don't have that, right? And that's a lot of work right there to scope out and design a new physical science building.
So what can I ask then on that?
If we were going to ask for $250 million, that wouldn't be the extension. That would be, you know,
that would be a separate bond.
What would you add to this list?
I don't know exactly how I would. I'm not sure. We just went down a list of things that we knew about and we stopped.
And stopped it.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. Okay. But it might be student services building. It might be campus.
Right. Theater. It would probably be. I think the next building on there would be student services.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
It's not very. It's built for an age. A new student services building is entirely different design today.
Yeah. The world has changed.
Yes.
Anna, are you done, Ellen?
I am, thank you.
I'm sorry.
Trustee Miller, just a couple of things that actually kind of returns us to where we were before we did the public comment. And it just has to do with one of the things that struck me about us having only gone out for two bonds since the 60s. And we only got one, right? Because the other one wasn't. Okay. And then again, this sort of has to do with, you know, with messaging as we're really going to decide soon whether we're doing it this year or postponing it. One of the things that occurs to me is that I was looking at NewsHawk, and there are two other schools that are going to present a bond this year. And now I understand we're still a little bit behind the eight ball in terms of going forward for 2024, but I do feel that it's so critical if we can do it to just do it. And because, you know, not having done it for so long, I mean, and with these pretty pictures, I do think the images that we don't, and we haven't spent the money, that we don't really need it. And that's such a misrepresentation of where we are and how urgent our situation is. So I just wanted to go back to that there are other schools, because somebody was mentioning that this is not, I think you mentioned this is not a good time, you know, because of, you know, economically, and there are other things, you know, going on. But I do think that these other schools are plowing forward. I forget which two.
Up in the Marina, in Santa Maria, and tomorrow night, Ventura District in will be voting on whether or not they're going for a bond for their three colleges.
You know, so I just feel kind of like, you know, I know we've had good rationale for not moving forward, you know, with all the instability at, you know, in terms of administration and all that. But if we can make this happen, I think we really should. We already decided that earlier. I know when now we're getting into the weeds, whether we can or not is something we're going to have to firmly decide on. But I just wanted to mention those other schools are going forward, and obviously, you know, we have to not be so timid, and we have to be bold. So anyway, just wanted to throw that up.
I totally agree with that. Let me ask this on the, we have to make a decision on June 20th. So later than June 27th. Mm-hmm. And we're scheduled, I think, to do that on June 27th, the day before we have to submit it to the county. And on the 27th, we'll have to, the board will be approving projects list, I assume.
Well, so the board is approving the projects list as it's presented, but because there is it's more than what the bond would be going for, it's not like you're saying, and then we're going to tick off this, and then we're going to tick off that. So the bond resolution language is written in such a way that it includes these things, but it also says, you know, these are the kinds of things that will be covered, because we need to tell the taxpayers. But I think it's important that it's not written in stone.
Let me try to clarify that, because
okay.
I'm not sure I completely understand. So the taxpayers are entitled to have a list
and
of what we're going to spend the money on.
And it's built into the resolution itself.
Right. And so what will it be? Will it be these items we're talking about, or will be some other
general description of those items?
Mm-hmm. Like, give me an example. How would it be?
HVACs, exterior and interior lighting, mm-hmm. Plumbing.
With or without dollars next to each
without
item.
Dollars. No
dollars.
With those general.
All our measures has is a number.
A total number.
Total number.
But not a breakdown.
But within the bond measure will be a listing of things like this without the individual dollar.
Correct. And without the detail that's here. And this is not much detail, but it will be less than that.
That's the clarification I'm looking for. Thank you.
On the bond measure, will it include language that indicates it's for all three campuses?
Correct.
Yes.
Yes. I think that's important.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yep. And the Children's Center, for that matter.
And we'll add landscaping.
I'm sorry, I don't mention you. Are you able to put that, you know, this is the first bond since 2008 actually in the You know, and I because that would be something that, because I believe it is correct. There's only been one since the 1960s that was in 2008. And if you're able to say, and in fact, if this is a continuation of the most recent one in 2008, you might even be able to wing it in that way.
I'm not sure. Yeah.
I think it's in the bond resolution. Now, we are held to, when it comes to the ballot itself, we're held to 75 words. So those words are chosen very carefully. Mm-hmm. But like the information booklet that comes out will include that kind of information. The campaign that is generated from this will definitely include that fact, because it's very important. That's information, incredible. Like you've pointed out, that it's not like we've gone, we've been successful in getting bonds.
It was almost 20 years ago.
Yeah, right.
And it was very small.
I know. It was 77 million or something, right?
Yep.
Okay. Are there any other questions or comments?
No, I like the list a lot.
Good. Thank you.
Good. So do I.
You too.
Okay. Well, I guess that's our.
Thank you.
Our agenda. Thank you very much.
One last one.
And Art has a question.
Am I going first, or is he?
No, I think.
Just real quickly. So, are we going to attempt a prioritizing or not?
So basically, what happens next? Like, let's say you all vote to put it on the ballot, and then it goes through and it passes. At that point is when the college develops two different ways of addressing this. One, and I'm using this from when I had bond money at LA Valley College, right, and I was in the process of setting this up at PCC, but came here. And that is, we have a shared governance group called the Bond Work Group.
Oh, okay.
And the Bond Work Group includes representation from across the college. And at Valley, we came together 2 times a month to get updates on what was happening with construction projects. But I was also in the middle of $650 million of building. And so there was a lot to report out on. It will take us a while to get up to that point. So okay. Those meetings will start, you know, once a month.
Okay.
But the bond work group will do an initial prioritization that then we bring to this committee and say, the bond work group has reviewed this, this, and this, and here's how they've prioritized the projects coming down. As the board, you ultimately make the decision as to what goes forward, but it's really important for the college to weigh in. So that's one piece of it. The second piece is that, let's say, work really begins on the PE building, or we get to do the physical sciences building, or any of these projects, something happening at Shot or Wake or what have you. Anywhere that human beings are going to be, like if it's a building, if it's an area or whatever, we then engage smaller groups to work with the design folks when things are being designed. We call those BUGs, building user groups.
Okay.
And the reason is because if you don't, then you might wind up with buildings where the people who actually work in the buildings were not ever consulted. And so a designer thought there was no need for a sink on this floor. Right. And then it turns out, well, there are three classes that are routinely taught on this floor that need a sink. Mm-hmm. And so... so there are various points, various places where the college community comes into it, but ultimately the decision is always the board.
Thanks for that explanation. I think I would add that, because I think that happened before both Anna and Ellen were on the board. As you know, there is a design already for the PE building.
Yes.
And that design did not appear until after there had been a lot of input,
right,
campus wide,
and in fact, Ellen, Kathy, Lindsay, and a few other people came to LA Valley College when I was still president there, because we have just built an athletic complex using bond funds, and they came and they met with my construction manager, and then they toured the building, and So I paid them a surprise visit. But they had also done due diligence by going out to other institutions that were in the process of looking at athletic complexes. And then we still have Art too.
Yeah, it's his turn. And then
Art, do you have another comment for us or question?
I think it's a question. And that is, a few months ago, when Dr. Murillo was here, she and the board talked about alternative routes or alternative ways to be able to access funds by borrowing against, and I can't remember what the budget term was.
Yeah. It's called a certificate of participation.
That's actually it.
Brian and I talked about it. Brian did a presentation. Brian, you want to talk a little bit about that?
Sure.
My question is, given those certificate of participation, if a bond measure did not pass, and also going back a few months in board meetings, the board did decide that the PE health building, whatever you're going to call it, is a priority and would go forth even if a bond measure did not pass. So would you then be going the certificate of participation route in order to access those funds so that the PE building was passed or was built? That's my question.
That's a great question. And I think I'll give you a lawyer's answer. It depends. I would not necessarily make a commitment to that just because right now we believe that our share would be $60 million and a certificate of participation on $60 million would have an annual payment of, what would you guess, Brian?
What? $7-8 million.
$7 or $8 million.
Out of our operating budget.
Yeah, out of our operating budget, which we don't have. So I think the board at the time made the decision that they had the most information to make at that point in time, because I think they were expressing support for and the need for the PE building. But I don't know that that would still be the decision, but there's no point in having that conversation because we're not there yet. But it is imperative, I think. I think it's safe to say it is imperative to pass this bond.
Okay.
My suggestion is that we think really hard about renaming the physical education complex. I think that,
I agree.
I don't know what it could be, but I think it's important.
Health and fitness. I agree. It's hard for me to think of something that would be legitimate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, we don't want to lie.
Paris Association.
Community services building.
Yeah. Colorable maybe is the colorable comment. Yes, Anna.
Just one last thing to follow up on Trustee Stoddard's remark. I agree that the messaging and maybe sort of rebranding of that building. But I also recognize the trickiness because we know that for those, the athletics department and that longstanding support, they're going to want a dedicated space. And then the problem is when you rename it, then it gets a little bit fuzzy about who has priority over the space. Mm-hmm. And I've been through these fights at UCSB when we were trying to get the new building and all, that's one of the tricky aspects, of it. So territorialism starts to happen, but you also have to, like you said, be mindful of, the fact that you need a PE aspect to this thing and it's dedicated.
Maybe PE complex and emergency response.
We have to get past the, are we doing it? And then once we get past that question, then it goes right into marketing and how it gets marketed.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So we're not there yet. We have to do the first part on the 27th. Oh yeah. And this is why, we have Charles Heath as our bond consultant, and he's actually going to be associated with one of the bonds up in Santa Maria as well. He was very successful with the PCC bond. He was very much part of messaging that bond, where we got 70.59% approval rating from the local taxpayers. So yeah, that's the next phase.
So the next stage of all this is the meeting on the 27th. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yep.
Good. I've been a active supporter of. I was very interested in doing the bond in 2022, and I think we would have succeeded, frankly, but decided not to do it. Well, I'm really hoping we'll make the right decision this time. And Lanny, thank you for coming to this.
Yeah, thank you. Well, yeah. Appreciate it.
Thanks for staying.
Yeah. All right. Awesome.
Okay. Well, the meeting is adjourned.
Thank you very much for coming and offering your feedback.